Welcome back to week 9, Marine Life, and in video 2, we are going to discuss and continue with how we classify marine organisms. So we went through how we classify and break organisms up into different kingdoms based on their structure or taxonomy. And in this chunk, we're going to look into their habitat, so where they live, and also their behavior. So the first way we kind of divide things up is where an organism lives based on their behavior and kind of where they live. So we have three different groups. We have what's called nectonic, planktonic, and benthic. And this is all based on where in the water column these organisms are kind of hanging out and moving in and out of. So we have in this diagram the seafloor at the very bottom, sea surface at the top. And at the very bottom, any organism that is living on the seafloor, attached to the seafloor, burrows into the seafloor sediments, or moves along the surface of the seafloor, this is called the benthic zone. The pelagic zone is the water that's all above the seafloor, and this can be entire column of the deep ocean, or it can be kind of more shallower when you get closer towards the edge of a continent. So the first one we're going to talk about is these nectonic organisms. These ones live in the water column, so they're up above the seafloor, and they're moving throughout the water column under their own power, so they can actually migrate from place to place. They use fins, jets, flukes, flippers, things like whales, fish, octopi, squid. These are all organisms that can actually move from one place to another in the ocean. And they'll go from maybe one edge of an ocean to another. They might migrate down to deeper depths and come back up while they're feeding or reproducing. So these organisms are all living in the water column and moving from place to place. The next type, planktonic. So these are also living in the pelagic zone. The only difference here between planktonic and nectonic is that planktonic organisms can't move on their own. They are kind of at the whim of ocean currents and tides, so they can't actually move under their own power. And these are usually pretty small organisms, such as plankton, like jellyfish. Certain species can't really migrate from place to place, different stages of life. Zooplankton, phytoplankton, these are all organisms that are at the whim of these ocean currents, but they are living in that pelagic zone. The last type, benthic, these are organisms that live on or at the bottom of the ocean. Some of them are attached, permanently fixed. Some of them can travel short distances. Things like sea stars would be a good example. It can travel a short distance. Some burrow into sediments, like worms, some types of clams will burrow into the loose sediments. And then organisms that are fixed include sea anemones, rock weed, seaweeds, are all organisms that are attached to the seafloor. So when we go on our field trip, we're going to be looking at the benthic zone primarily, because those organisms aren't going to be able to move when the tides go in and out, so they're kind of stuck. And so we will get to explore and check out some of these different critters. So these are these three zones, nectonic, planktonic, benthic, all based on their behavior and where these organisms live. The next way we divide up organisms is based on how they eat in the food chain. So we have this kind of order of organisms here that go from producer to primary consumer, secondary consumer, tertiary consumer, and then decomposer. So we break up these organisms based on how they eat and what they eat. So we have autotrophs, heterotrophs, and decomposers are the main categories. And these, the food chain or how they eat, this is basically the feeding relationships within an environment. So if you go to a tide pool, who's eating who, basically, in that tide pool? Who's, you know, at the top? Who's a predator? And who is kind of the lowly critter that's just going to get eaten? So these organisms can be broken up into different trophic levels. So this is based on what it eats and what eats it. So it's location within the food chain. So if we look at primary consumers eat producers, and secondary consumers eat primary consumers. So we kind of place them based on where in that food chain they exist. And then throughout this whole food chain, both matter and energy are moving through the food chain as each organism feeds. So those producers at the very bottom of the food chain are going to be producing energy, and then that energy and matter is going to be transmitted into the next organism along that food chain. So to talk about these different types here, the first group are what are called autotrophs, and these are organisms that are absorbing energy and transform inorganic minerals and nutrients into organic molecules. So things like photosynthetic algae are as a good example of a critter that's going to be producing its own food through energy from the sun. So we see a lot of algae in the oceans. We also see organisms, especially at mid-ocean ridges, at the very bottom of the ocean where sunlight can't reach, we see chemosynthesis. So energy is coming from the breaking of chemical bonds. So these autotrophs are actually breaking down some of these chemicals and inorganic compounds that come out of those mid-ocean ridges and are producing some organic compounds so that can actually digest, or for the next person on the food chain or organism in the food chain to be able to digest. So these are autotrophs. They make their own food, and they are the bottom of the food chain. And of course, in this picture, they're at the top, but they are what everything depends on. If we don't have any producers or autotrophs, we lose a big chunk of our energy source, because they are the ones producing these nutrients through the sun or through chemical reactions. So those are autotrophs. The next category are what are called heterotrophs. These are organisms that consume autotrophs or other heterotrophs. So we are a good example. I am a vegetarian, so I would be in this primary consumer category. So I eat autotrophs, whereas someone else that might eat meat might be considered a secondary consumer because they consume mostly primary consumers. So these vegetarians that were going to eat the vegetables or the producers. And then the next up on this food chain would be tertiary consumers, and these consume secondary consumers. So heterotrophs don't make their own food. They rely on others for food. A good example in a tide pool environment might be, let's say a producer could be some photosynthetic algae that's living in the water. That algae gets eaten or filtered out of the water by mussels that live attached to the rocky surfaces. And then, so that's considered a primary consumer. And then those mussels are eaten by sea stars. Sea star would be considered a secondary consumer. And then sea stars might be eaten by seal, maybe they're eaten by a seagull, so those would be considered tertiary consumers. And then once they die, these organisms break down, and then they get actually broken down by these decomposers, which is the next category that we're going to talk about. And these decomposers are organisms that consume detritus, which is dead or partially decayed plant and animal tissues, and organic waste. So you have two different categories here. You've got decomposing bacteria and detritus feeders. And decomposing bacteria are actually breaking down that detritus into inorganic compounds. So they're breaking it down further to basically compost that material. Detritus feeders filter detritus, this dead or partially decayed material, from the water. So they're filter feeding in the ocean. And a lot of these detritus feeders and decomposing bacteria live along the ocean floor. So these would be primarily benthic. You might see some that live in the water column, but for the most part, they're going to be on the ocean floor. So that's the food chain as a whole. We've got producers, primary consumers, secondary, tertiary consumers, and then decomposers. And we can also classify these by autotroph, heterotroph, and decomposers. So that wraps up how we classify these marine organisms. We went over based on their eating habits, based on their living habits, and then also their structure or taxonomy. So we'll come back in the next video and talk about what kind of conditions these organisms have to adapt to.